Half a century ago, Seattle threw a party and invited the world. America was in the midst of a Cold War, living in the atomic age, and launching a furious space race. In Seattle, a handful of civic leaders embarked on an audacious plan to put their city on the map. They would build a tower in the sky.
We're really going to build that thing?
A cathedral to science.
This fair was a celebration of ideas.
And a monument to the transportation of the future.
It really was a mind-blowing time.
It was about the future, so I loved it.
They invited the world to a six-month party filled with culture, cuisine, and celebrity. And they changed their city forever.
Meet me in Seattle at the fair. If you wanna kiss me there. I'll be waiting to start that celebrating. Meet me in Seattle, that's where I'll be at. I'll meet you in Seattle at the fair.
The 1962 World's Fair, when Seattle invented the future. Father Knows Best and I Love Lucy, Senator McCarthy hunting communists, fallout shelters, and duck and cover.
Gone like a coon.
Civil rights and segregation. Rock and roll. The 50s weren't really the simpler time of memory. The stage was set for the 60s. During the war, Seattle had filled the skies with Boeing bombers. Now it settled into being a remote company town.
Seattle back in the late 50s, early 60s was a little bit of a sleepy place.
I've traveled all over this country, and I'll say that if man ever found a place to be peaceful and quiet, that spot is on Puget Sound. No longer a slave of ambition, I laugh at the world and its shams as I think of my happy condition, surrounded by acres of clams.
Perhaps it's fair to characterize it as kind of a quiet, non-progressive period.
Out of this charming obscurity, a few civic leaders decided to embark on an outrageous gamble, a gamble that exceeded their wildest dreams.
The Seattle World's Fair is a fair that never should have happened.
At that time, everybody said, you can't do it.
People thought if you lived in Seattle, you must live in an igloo up next to Nome.
Seattle was not a big city then. It was far, far away.
Seattle civic leaders were looking for an event that would make the world sit up and take notice. It fell to City Councilman Al Rochester to spark the idea of a World's Fair in Seattle.
My dad was kind of the flavor of old Seattle. He was a man about town. Never missed a meeting, never missed a gathering, never missed a funeral.
In 1955, over drinks at the Washington Athletic Club, Rochester proposed an idea.
When he was a young man, he had experienced the Alaska-Yukon-Pacific Exposition, and it imprinted on him all his life that it was the most exciting thing that ever happened in this city. And my dad said, well, the best show I ever saw in this town was AYP. Why don't we do something to bring AYP back, in a manner of speaking, with a modern theme?
Besides the idea man, Al Rochester, there was Eddie Carlson, an executive for Weston Hotels, the fair's visionary.
Being physically small put a little edge on him and gave him a kind of pleasantly aggressive personality.
Ewan Dingwall was brought in from government to become the manager.
He was responsible for taking this sort of critical mass of great ideas and making them actually happen.
And Joe Gandy, a charming lawyer turned Ford dealer, was the salesman.
Joe Gandy, who would never take no, never take no from anyone. Everything was possible.
It was over 7 a.m. breakfast meetings at the Olympic Hotel that the fair would gain its structure.
You see this group of people who came together who really had nothing particularly in common. They were all successful businessmen who loved this community and got this wild idea that they could do something.
They originally started with ideas about just having a festival of the West.
On October 4th, 1957, at the height of the Cold War, the Russians dramatically changed the subject.
Today, a new moon is in the sky, a 23-inch metal sphere placed in orbit by a Russian rocket.
I remember vividly Sputnik, you know, this little basketball-sized thing made a huge impression, because for the first time, we realized that the Russians were really capable of big things.
We present an address by the President of the United States, Dwight D. Eisenhower.
The Soviet launching of Earth satellites is an achievement of the first importance. One of our greatest and most glaring deficiencies is the failure of us in this country to give high priority enough to scientific education and to the place of science in our national life.
The focus became on educating children about science, and so therefore it became a science-related World's Fair.
I think that the fair went to science because Warren Magnuson brilliantly saw that this was a way to bring federal dollars to the table.
With optimism and the fair's new futuristic theme, Joe Gandy and his team headed to Paris to gain official World's Fair recognition from the Bureau of International Expositions, the BIE.
In competition at that time was New York, San Francisco, and Moscow, and Seattle, and no one had ever even heard of Seattle.
We had to make a new beginning for the slide presentation to show them where Seattle was. So they started with a slide of the whole globe, but gradually focused in on the U.S., and then away over here on the other side of the country from Washington, D.C., was this other Washington.
They had approved the New York World's Fair in 1939, but a lot of the international exhibitors at that fair were furious with New York because of labor problems. If you had a foreign pavilion, you couldn't even change a light bulb in it. You had to have a New York union guy do it at a grossly inflated cost.
This labor union thing, the contract he had for no striking, went a long ways to sell it.
He blustered and he talked and he had the facts and he had people around him who could produce the right figures, and BIA, after their consultations, decided, well, let's take a shot and Seattle became a, quote, World's Fair.
But audacious goals need spectacular symbols. They would need to create a fair that was both dazzling and enduring.
This is Mr. Edward Carlson, the president of Western Hotels and the chairman of the Washington State World's Fair Commission. Mr. Carlson might well be referred to as the father of the Space Needle, and perhaps we can have you explain to us just exactly how this all came about, Mr. Carlson.
Thank you, Bill. Well, Mrs. Carlson and I were in Stuttgart, Germany, May of 1959, and we had dinner in the television tower at that time.
And my dad said that he didn't sleep very well that night, and he was already consumed by the fair and how it was going to go, and he said he kept thinking about the importance of tall structures. He said there's the Eiffel Tower, of course, and there's the TV Tower in Tokyo. He said it is even the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Why do people come to Pisa to see the tower? And he said not only do people want to see these things, they want to go up in them. He got up very early and went down to the hotel coffee shop.
And I sketched out on a pen a tower much like that, and I put a ring around the top of it and looked at it, and I thought, well...
That was sort of like the inception of a needle with a flying saucer on the top of it.
You know, UFO on a stick.
From that sketch on a napkin, the Space Needle came.
They showed the idea to John Graham, who eventually was the architect for the Space Needle.
We had any number of more or less imaginative designs, but it needed to have legs to hold up the load of the top house.
Graham worked with numerous outside architects, including University of Washington architecture professor Victor Steinbrück.
This is a personal logbook written by my father in his own hand. During the time that I was on the needle, I probably made 1,000 or 1,500 drawings of ideas. One evening, I thought of and put down on paper the essential structural concept and basic form that has become the needle. I came out and told Elaine that, I've got it. The actual inspiration or source of the idea is the aesthetic concept of the wooden sculpture of David Lemons that we've had for about 10 years. Dave calls it the feminine one.
But the city had no money for building such an icon. Five civic leaders stepped forward to fund the needle privately, among them Ned Skinner.
My dad was one of the people, along with Begley Wright and John Graham and Howie Wright and others, who basically put the Space Needle idea together.
In 1960, when they were planning the Space Needle, they wanted to know what the view would be like.
So they went up in their helicopter and got to a level that they thought was probably an appropriate height and said, let's do it here.
Here was 605 feet high. When completed, it would be the tallest structure west of the Mississippi.
We're really going to build that thing?
The tower is deep-rooted for permanency.
And they dug and dug and dug.
Down these troughs, 30 feet to the bottom, went the largest continuous building concrete pour in the West.
The concrete really works as a counterweight. And so the center gravity for the Space Needle is actually at ground level.
What concerned us most was schedule.
You know, many people don't understand that the Space Needle actually was bolted together. It's pieces of steel that were bolted one by one to go up 605 feet and to complete the structure that we have today. The first time that I came to the Space Needle, I was 4 years old, and I went with my father. And so we went up in this rickety construction elevator, and I had a little construction hat on. And I can remember wrapping my arms around my dad's legs. I was so scared. So we finally made it to the top. The doors opened. I remember getting on my hands and knees and crawling to the edge and looking over, and I was absolutely scared to death.
One step is 500 feet down. The towering symbol of the fair was completed without a single lost time accident on the job.
I thank my lucky stars.
In my opinion, the World's Fair would not have been successful without the Space Needle. The Space Needle made the fair.
It has an uplifting feel to it that sort of springs upward.
It captured all the things about the future, about science, about fantasy, about enterprise, about aspiration that the fair hoped to embody.
Below the privately funded Space Needle, federal dollars were at work.
On Federal Knoll, they're completing the open Gothic spires that will greet visitors to the magnificent $9 million U.S. Science Pavilion.
It was designed by Seattle-born architect Minoru Yamasaki.
I think it's one of his crowning achievements. It really was kind of a temple on the hill. The water that they used was very far ahead of its time.
Minoru Yamasaki got the job to build the World Trade Center because the New York Port Authority sent guys from New York to see the Science Pavilion.
The state of Washington tapped Seattle architect Paul Theory to design the massive coliseum that would house their pavilion.
From what I recall, was inspired by the rain hats that were woven by the natives that kind of had this low sloping shedding quality.
That building was built anticipating a technology that didn't exist. So it literally was cables strung in a circus tent manner. So the roof leaked for decades.
At the very heart of the fair was the International Fountain. The design competition was won by a pair of architects from Tokyo.
And the Japanese were very proud because it was designed by a Japanese team. These designers came in out of the blue and proposed something just way out, you know, this singing fountain. It's blew the mind, and they just said, the hell with the budget, let's go with it. I remember that.
But a lot of the things that they were anticipating, we did not have the engineering and technology to implement. For the fair, there was a person, a man, who sat in an underground bunker with a tiny little window and modulated the water to the music. People believed the technology was making the water dance to the music.
As a powerful symbol of the transportation of the future, the Swedish corporation Allweg designed and built the monorail from downtown Seattle to the fair site.
You'd read about it like in a Popular Mechanics or Popular Science magazine, monorail or something in Japan, but no, we're going to have one in Seattle and you're going to get to ride in it.
Are you ready for your monorail ride?
Construction on America's first rapid transit monorail got underway. There are approximately 140 beams in the line,
and the train snuggles like an inverted horseshoe on the rail beam. They do much to provide the cushioned, rubber-tired ride of the monorail.
Well, we made it right on time. And right behind me is Stan Davis with our creepy peepee, the camera which took the pictures along the entire monorail route. Boy, you did a fine job, Stan.
Thanks very much,
great.
Bill.
So the fair was a potent combination of public and private money.
Public investment makes it possible. Private investment makes it spectacular. Look at the Space Needle. It would have fallen off the table had private not come in to do it.
It was one thing to build a World's Fair, but another to actually get the world to come.
There were wonderful plans, a great facility, and no exhibitors.
It was not an easy sell.
Well, my father went to 64 countries in all to try to get them to come and participate. He was in South America. I do not know which country. He was there for 4 days. During the 4 days, they had four coups, and he ended up writing contracts underneath the table as machine guns were going at him.
The fair offices themselves have 1,800 employees, including these in the press agency office.
I traveled a lot with Joe Gandy, who was the president of the fair.
He ran the Ford Motor dealership here.
Ford Motor would not come. And seven times he wrote them and called them or whatever. And seven times they refused him.
And we had an appointment with Leah Iacocca and some of the staff there.
And he did not take no for an answer. He went for it.
And we did a kind of a dog and pony show.
And they did come.
If Ford's going to come in, Chevrolet says, you know, maybe we ought to think about going to the fair.
The fair fully filled their space. Then they built a whole nother pavilion just to hold more exhibitors. It was very successful.
With exhibitors lining up, it fell to PR director Jay Rocky to orchestrate the campaign to bring millions of people to the fair.
Life magazine, they did two covers. One cover along about February. It was really helpful because they put the Space Needle on the cover. And a lot of people began to believe that, oh, this really is going to happen.
I will be your guide. You will be my dog. We will have a home. Remember, if you want us, we have to be there.
In this office, housing reservations in hotels, motels, private homes, camping grounds.
Yes, sir. Now, is that one couple and five children? Five dogs.
In the first 30 days, we sold 100,000 tickets.
The Seattle Century 21 Exposition. For the family vacation of a lifetime, filled with fun, as exciting as tomorrow, and truly educational.
Yep, skedaddle.
To Seattle.
See the monorail in her glory, make happy people sigh. They'll ride along her rail of steel up in Seattle's sky.
The advanced ticket sale just knocked everybody's socks off.
We'll see you there, the World's Fair at Century 21.
Are you going to be at the fair too?
Oh yeah, Dad, I'm going to be out there snubbing around that Space Needle.
Really? Really?
Yeah.
April 21st, 1962, the Space Age Fair was ready, but would it get off the ground?
We went to the Space Needle and looked down on the fairgrounds when the fair opened, and it was just a trickle of people, you know, and everybody thought, oh, my God, what have we done?
All the parking lots were empty. We couldn't believe we were seeing right. Where are all the people?
I forget the exact figure because I tried to forget it.
Well, what happened was people didn't want to get into a massive crowd situation, and so they stayed away the first few days.
The initial crowds might have disappointed organizers, but the world saw a spectacular opening, and soon the numbers far exceeded expectations.
The first World's Fair in the United States in 22 years has its gala opening in Seattle.
I think opening day signified sort of Seattle coming of age. The whole world was coming to our little town.
On opening day of the fair, it just was almost like a magical experience. I will never forget that.
There are 74 acres of educational and entertainment exhibits at this $80 million exposition that is expected.
My first job when I came here was to help coordinate the opening day ceremonies. And they said, what we want you to do is to coordinate the speech by President John F. Kennedy to open the fair. Well, on the day of the fair itself, I started talking to the people there, saying that, you know, we have about 5 minutes to go. And the person I was talking to was asking me, how are the crowds there? What's the fair like? You know, what's the weather like? Is it exciting? And then I realized that we were about a minute to go before the president was to speak. And so I said, is the president standing by? And the person I've been talking to all this time said, this is the president. And I just froze. And after this, what seemed like a forever long pause, President Kennedy says over the telephone to me, isn't it about time that I should start? And all I could say was, yes, Mr. President.
He presses a historic gold key.
May we open an era of peace and understanding. Let the fair begin.
And the fair is on.
I'm Joe Gandy, president of the Seattle World Fair, offering you a few of the sights and sounds of the spectacular Century 21 Exposition.
See you in Seattle. See you at the fair. Take a way ahead look at tomorrow, just as if you were there. Take a rocket trip to Mars. Have your dinner way up in the clouds. Stroll the boulevards of the world. Have fun with the happy-go-lucky crowds. See you in Seattle at the big World's Fair.
Everybody's talking about the big World's Fair in Seattle, where a thousand different thrills are setting the pace for a fascinating trip into a world of space. You zoom to the moon, take a ride in the star. You'll be in orbit wherever you are. See you in Seattle at the big World's Fair.
But the fair had a serious purpose under its glittering surface. Could it inspire Americans with its scientific vision of the future?
This fair was a celebration of ideas. No one knew exactly how fast we were going to get to that future, and frankly, it didn't matter. What it did is it put you into a mindset that said, we can do this.
I love the Science Center. You know, I was trained as an engineer. That part of the fair really was exciting and innovative.
The Science Pavilion worked so hard not to be an engineering pavilion in order to encourage children to go into careers in science.
For a kid that already had kind of a nascent love for science and science fiction-like things in the future, it took all that to the next level.
With a special kind of curiosity and a sense of elegance, the scientist uncovers hidden relationships.
To see real science, it wasn't that far out of reach. And when you're nine, you're so impressionable. It's so important to show people what's possible, and then they can think, well, maybe I can do that too.
The electronic computer, can sift through, condense, and relate tremendous amounts of data at such great speed that complex theories for handling information become exceedingly practical. This comes close to the heart of science.
But in 1962, the fair portrayed a future that still looked and sounded a lot like the present.
I've been having a very stimulating conversation here with Judy Hansen. We're previewing the official uniform for you science demonstrators. Will you describe it for us in typical woman talk?
I'd love to. This is a blue sheath with the United States Science Exhibit emblem and U.S. insignia buttons.
And it's a beautiful uniform, and you look very beautiful in it.
Thank you.
Selected from more than 300 applicants, the science demonstrators have received an intensive 3 months training course.
Fortunately, I was selected to be one of the 40, and we prepared for 6 months. They gave us training on how to sit, how to walk, how to talk, do the demos.
We've been learning basic principles of sciences, including biology, chemistry, physics, bacteriology,
trajectories to the moon and back.
Some of these science demonstrators have been preconditioning a group of 24 pigeons.
Worked with rhesus monkeys in the animal lab.
For girls, there was a sense that you could become an engineer or a chemist or a biologist or a botanist. If you're a mom, you know, you come with your family, so your daughter is sort of, there's lots for her to do. But as mom or grandma, you're going to be much happier among the perfumed pools, looking at the fashion show, looking at how meals will cook themselves in the 21st century, and laundry will wash itself and fold itself. So your domestic concerns, the fair is willing to deal with them.
Here you can see a variety of products. Some of them are already available, others just around the corner.
You'll be able to reach frequently called numbers by dialing only 2 digits.
It seems like it was so far in the future.
There were things that I just couldn't imagine.
The turbine engine-powered car of the future has no key. It'll be locked and unlocked by a sonic pencil. Highways of the future may be electrically controlled for completely accident-free driving. An adding machine that's operated by voice alone. On this telephone, you can see as well as hear the person you're talking to.
Can you see it okay?
The marvelous telephone line, which can transcribe your signature coast to coast immediately you write it. All of these things, they tell us, will be commonplace in the city of the future.
And we think you'll agree, after seeing the many exhibits we have here, there is no end to progress now or in Century 21.
The Washington State Pavilion featured a dramatic and provocative presentation called The Threshold and the Threat, and you entered by way of the Bubbleator.
The Bubbleator. What kind of a crazy thing was that?
Honestly, people pined for the Bubbleator for decades.
I remember the Bubbleator.
Oh, the Bubbleator. How could you not go to the fair and go into the Bubbleator?
I love going up and down in the bubble, the elevator, the bubble elevator.
It was the thing to do.
You almost felt like you were in outer space.
Three steps to the rear of the sphere.
But it was basically just a lift, you know? But there was something really cool about it.
Utopia, Century 21.
This was a carefully scripted experience, which I think embodies the buoyant optimism of the fair and also this sort of brooding sense of dread that hung over the fair.
This was the future. You better find out what's going on in the world. Take change by the hand before it takes you by the throat.
And they would shuffle out in the dimness, and as they left the Bubbleator, the voice of the narrator began, and it was this over-narration about the opportunities for choice that people had in 1962, that there's no problem that couldn't be solved by science and engineering. That's the threshold, but then there's the threat that we could blow ourselves to kingdom come or be blown there with a sort of savage mutual destruction. And it was meant to be life-changing, and it was meant to encourage people to remake the world.
Nowhere was the furious competition with the Soviets more apparent than the space race. And the men who risked their lives with each new launch became instant heroes.
Irv,
Yulan Titov of Russia returns to Earth after orbiting the globe 17 times in a little more than 25 hours.
Here we are in the middle of the Cold War. The commies are our enemies. There's that half of it, but at the same time, there's a fascination. They want to know, who are these people?
The Russian cosmonaut impressed everybody. Now, he didn't say all good things when he got here. He talked a little bit like Russia's program in space was far beyond ours, and I guess they were at that point. He was here with his wife, and he bragged a lot, and I guess he could. I guess he should have.
Less than a week after the cosmonaut, America's space hero showed up.
John Brenn reports zero G, and I feel fine. He says the view is tremendous.
Tell me, Mr. Glenn, what did you see when you went up there?
As our astronauts went up and successfully came back, most of them came out here.
These astronauts were superstars. They just generated a lot of excitement wherever they went.
My father and John Glenn met back in 1943, and they were very good friends and stayed friends throughout their careers in the Marine Corps. He'd rub my short red hair, my crew cut.
Is it true what they say of the star above?
NASA was a new organization, and this was a way to educate people about what NASA was working on.
Right. It was NASA's absolutely first public demonstration of what they were up to and how they were trying to put a man on the moon.
He slept in my bedroom downstairs, and I guess it was the NASA people who did it, but they brought all these photographs and newspaper articles, and they plastered this wall around where the bed was that it was sleeping in. And the article in the, I think it was the Seattle Times, was saying, you know, Kenny Rainforest, a hero, is John Glenn, and he has all these photographs and stuff on his wall, and he's going, well, yeah, not really. I mean, my hero is my father.
I want to go, Mr. Glenn.
Roger.
Mr. Glenn.
Friendship 7, a real fireball outside.
But science wasn't the only new frontier. The fair threw open its doors to world culture in all its forms, high and low.
The opening night concert was electrifying. They had the grand opening of the Seattle Opera House with Milton Kadams conducting the Seattle Orchestra with Van Cliburn performing.
Something I'll never forget as long as I live, Van Cliburn.
And then the second half was Igor Stravinsky.
He had to be helped out on stage, all bent over like a gnome.
It seemed like it was a struggle to lift the baton, and he lifted the baton to start the symphony, and he went, and he was gone, and he was all of a sudden a 25-year-old man conducting
the Firebird Suite. It was the most thrilling thing I ever recall.
Hearing great music every day, of seeing great art every day.
It was international acts. It was incredible.
One time we were at the fair and we went and saw this wonderful Spanish dancer.
And someplace that was really fun late at night was the Hofbräuhaus.
One of the greatest events in the fair was the tattoo. And it's a great military pageant with the Canadian Mounties. Fill the high school stadium for every event.
But bringing the world to Seattle highlighted some racial divisions that many had preferred to ignore.
At the beginning of the World's Fair, I think that there might have been a feeling in the local community of black people that, well, what's this all about? This is not for us. I think once they started seeing people like Belafonte showing up, there was this whole another interest.
My train will come.
Prior to the World's Fair, there were clubs that would hire either all black bands or all white bands. You were not supposed to be mixing the two.
I was with a band called Tiny Tony and the Statics. Tony was a 300-pound
black man. We called him 300 pounds of twist, and he was very animated on stage.
We started having rock and roll dances for teenagers.
A son of one of the managers had gone to the dance and liked the music, but said the band had an objectionable Elvis air, and we seemed greasy. So the manager, in his memo to all the other managers, said we must be careful in our future bookings so that we don't draw the Birdland crowd. Birdland was a big rhythm and blues black club.
There were many white people who felt that Seattle was without sin. Many people who had talked a good game about brotherhood were put to the test.
The Musicians Union, prior to that time, there were two locals, and they were segregated. One was white and one was black. And during the World's Fair, you put these things together because Seattle had to grow up and be an international city.
The fair also brought Seattle face to face with the great international art of the era.
We had major artists like Jasper Johns, Roy Lichtenstein. This was pre-pop, really. I mean, right when pop was happening. We had Gene Arp, we had Henry Moore in exhibitions.
These were grand artists, and they were in their prime. And it was a magical thing to have going on, to be able to go see the work as it was exhibited.
This was the first time these Northwest artists, most of them never have had an opportunity for financial reasons to travel. So they were seeing art by some of their heroes.
There was a change in Seattle, whether one knew you needed it or not.
There was not an art world before the fair. After the fair, there was a definitive art world. There was an opportunity to make a living in art.
The things that provided some kind of entertainment and stimulus intellectually were the things that people seemed to find most interesting, besides Gracie Hansen.
She's the apple of Seattle's eye, Miss Gracie Hansen.
Adele came in to see me one day when we were organizing the fair.
And I just went in cold and said, I want to put on a show.
I said, what kind of a entertainment would you like to have? She says, a girly show.
They said, well, Miss Hansen, you know, don't you call us, we'll call you.
I have this little pet theory that science will never replace sex or cotton candy. You know, really, I'm a long, long way from Morton.
Well, Morton is two blocks long, has 1,140 people, and quite a few of those are children.
But a friend of mine said, gee, look what you've done with the Morton Follies. Why don't you get up to Seattle with the World's Fair?
So I started to look for a job in Seattle.
I see.
And I found one in the Savings and Loan Association.
My father, Robert Chin, had started United Savings and Loan Bank, and that was the first Asian-owned bank in the United States.
Chinese are the greatest gamblers in the world, you know. So he asked me how much money I needed, and I said, well, probably $100,000. So he called up 28 Chinese people and asked them if they would each put up $5,000, and 18 of them said they would.
Wow. Quite controversial, especially in the Chinese community.
Gracie Hansen's Night in Paradise. Now, this was produced by Barry Ashton, who was a producer from Las Vegas, and he did a real Las Vegas style show on Show Street, and it had the showgirls, it had singers and dancers, it had nightclub acts.
There was, you know, always a little controversy about what was going on down in Show Street. Was that too racy?
Actually, the women part was the lesser part of her show.
They had a number of really interesting shows there. One of them was Sid and Marty Krofft, who did La Poupée de Paris, which was an adult puppet show, which was fabulous. It was so good that it went on to the New York World's Fair in 1964.
And the funny thing, too, was about the Gracie Hansen show, which had these beautiful showgirls. was everyone came back talking about this dog, Louis.
The best dog act I've ever seen in my life.
It was very funny, and the dog could do nothing.
In fact, Louis steals the show every night. That's Bobby Williams' dog.
For a lot of people, it just wouldn't be a fair without rides and food.
Throngs and throngs of people. The fairgrounds were just, you know, dense with people in all directions. Attractions, sights everywhere, fun stuff to do, like the wild mouse.
The wild mouse, that was really scary.
The sky ride that actually was an overview of the fair. You went on almost like a gondola.
We went to the top of the needle and we did what everybody did. They had one payphone at the top of the Space Needle. And so what you would do is you would call your friends and say, guess where I am? I'm at the top of the Space Needle.
We did pastel profiles, you know, that took about 7 to 10 minutes to do. And then when we were sitting around doing nothing, you know, we drew each other. We were paid $1 a piece. And I did like 3,000 of them during the season.
We were a meat and potato society. But in Century 21, carnival food mixed with world cuisine.
There was a French restaurant in the food circus. My mother, who spoke French, ordered frog's legs. And I got all kinds of credibility being able to go back to grade school and tell people I ate a frog over the weekend, you know.
Tempura prawn, some kind of a brown sauce on it, and I just devoured those.
Argentinian beef was pretty good.
Dessert, I think it was called like the Lunar Orbiter or something.
Very long frankfurters from Denmark.
Corn dogs on stick, you know, the deep fried ones with mustard.
Mate tea.
Apple skeevers.
Most vivid memory is my grandpa bought me Belgian waffles.
Belgian waffles. I'd never seen one before, never heard the term before.
This was like, ooh la la.
I think maybe a Belgian waffle.
Probably Belgian waffles.
Well, Belgian waffles were a big deal.
The Belgian waffles were, everybody talked about.
The Belgian waffles, yeah.
Belgian waffles.
Belgian waffles.
I thought the Belgian waffles were really good.
Fresh strawberries.
They had all that whipping cream on top.
It's like sacred knowledge. They will not disclose their recipes.
All that stuff we did eat to put it in our gullet.
All the strawberries and the cream and 10,000 calories.
They were really good.
The World's Fair brought a glittering array of celebrities to town.
I had a regular 8mm movie camera, so I started documenting things that I saw around the fairgrounds, not really thinking at the time that I was really capturing some of the most famous people that ever entered onto the fairground site. Adlai Stevenson and Governor Nelson Rockefeller, Richard Nixon, the Reverend Billy Graham. I was certainly impressed with being able to meet the great Edward R. Murrow.
Vice President Lyndon Johnson.
Hubert Humphrey.
Bobby Kennedy.
My brother was the first face he saw as Ethel and the tribe got off the monorail train, and my brother was in awe of the Kennedy clan and Bobby being very personal and just the typical Kennedy charisma.
The handsome Duke of Edinburgh piloted his own airplane into Seattle after spending 4 days fishing and riding horseback up in British Columbia.
He had one little PR man and a fellow from Scotland Yard, that was about the extent of it. And his PR man hadn't told him that he was supposed to say a few nice parting words. And so he turned to me and he says, well, what are we here for? And I said, well, we'd like you to say a few words. And he kind of looked like a frown. He says, what am I, a trained seal?
You'll be much better going around the exhibition. And I hope you're enjoying it as much as I am. And a very good afternoon to you all.
He had a wonderful sense of humor.
I hate to say it, he was really a stuffed shirt.
Roy Rogers and Dale Evans, we did an ABC television special that we shot here. They were the nicest people to work with.
One of the guys from the union called me up and said, Peggy Lee's coming into town. And they wanted me to become her production manager. And that was an entirely new experience for me.
Lawrence Welk, because he stayed around and signed every single autograph.
Marie Chevalier.
Les McCann.
The Little Lennon Sisters.
Victor Borge.
Johnny Mathis.
George Burns.
Bob Hope was there.
Miles Davis walked in.
Mike Nichols and Elaine May.
Carl Chandler.
Carl Reiner.
I remember taking Fats Domino.
And then the king showed up.
And there was really one movie that came out of the fair, and that was the Elvis Presley movie.
There was nothing more exciting than the fact that Elvis is on the fairgrounds today.
Take me to the fair. Take me to the fair. Don't know anywhere I would rather be.
I was working at the monorail concession stand, and down the ramp comes Elvis Presley with all his entourage.
I'm an Elvis fan, so I loved it. You know, I swooned.
He autographed a little bags for us.
And he'd wave to us. So, oh, well, you know, wow, Elvis.
He had a great smile, and he had hair that was pitch black, and it looked like it was full of grease.
I was 21 years old by that time, and he started addressing me as Mr. Fisher. I thought, come on, this is Elvis. This is the king. You don't call me Mr. Fisher.
Come on and be my little good luck charm.
I was dating Dick Friel at the time, and one of his clients was Northwest Releasing, which brought in all the shows, and he was assigned to Elvis. The very last day of the shoot, Colonel Parker turned to Dick and said, I promised Governor Rosalini at the end of the shoot I would give him a Tennessee ham. Could you go down to the AMP and get me a ham? So I could tell that story after 50 years.
And suddenly, it was October. On the last afternoon of the last day, Earl Addis decided to take his family for one last visit to the fair.
We stepped out of the line buying the tickets, and somebody hung this sign up which says, the 10th million visitor. And I said, oh?
It had been such a magical 6 months. We were just all so sad to see it close, and yet we knew it had to come to an end.
Well, the last day was anticlimactic, because we knew it was coming. Now we had to find out ways to tear everything down, clean them up, make our records clear, report to our bosses, and go home.
At the close of the fair, John Kennedy was supposed to come out and close it in person.
Well, I have some friends who worked for the president at the time and said we were on our way.
He left Chicago claiming he was ill and couldn't come west. He was going to go back to Washington to take care of his cold.
And with a tear in their every heart, I now officially commit the Seattle World's Fair to history.
The lights, of course, were always on. 24 hours a day. So when the fair closed at midnight, all the lights went off. So the next morning, all the leaves fell off the trees, and it was very quiet, and nothing was picked up. It was a very strange feeling to walk across the grounds.
Good evening, my fellow citizens. This government, as promised, has maintained the closest surveillance of the Soviet military buildup on the island of Cuba.
The very next day, it was the announcement of the Cuba crisis.
To halt this offensive buildup, a strict quarantine on all offensive military equipment
under shipment to Cuba is being initiated.
The fear. We were all watching television, watching Kennedy give a speech that we could be bombed at any point.
We were sorry he didn't get there, but we were glad he coped with the Cuban Missile Crisis.
After the fear and optimism, the exhaustion and elation, it was time to take stock.
Seattle did it. We did it. We'd made money, which was astounding.
And they made $1 million.
I don't think they set out to do it because it was going to make a profit, that they were profit-oriented. The profits they saw is really more cultural and civic.
These people could both be salesmanly enough to bring the world to the fair and also altruistic enough to want to leave something for their city.
My father felt it was absolutely economically immoral to have only memories left from the fair. He wanted buildings that the city could use.
Out of the glittering panorama of this fair, there will rise a civic center that will inspire the generations to come to keep its eye on the space age and to nourish understanding in its heart.
You know, he said, we're building a great civic center, but we're disguising it as a World's Fair.
Their vision was to create something that would put Seattle on the map, that would be financially successful, and that would create a cultural center.
If you think that prior to the World's Fair, there were probably two or three arts institutions in the community, and now look at what we have.
Seattle Repertory Theater.
Seattle Children's Theater.
Seattle Storm Women's Basketball.
Intimon.
Booket Repertory Theater.
Seattle Shakespeare Company.
Seattle Opera.
Teatro Zinzani.
Pacific Northwest Ballet.
Seattle International Film Festival.
The Vera Project.
Northwest Folklife Festival.
Festal Cultural Festivals.
Seattle Pride Festival.
Whirligig.
Winterfest.
Pacific Science Center.
Bite of Seattle.
Bumbershoot.
Rat City Roller Girls.
Theater Puget Sound.
Experience Music Project.
We have something unique in the nation. There are not many places that consciously and intentionally create a space for all people where they are all mixing. I came to believe that it's in those moments where we actually create community.
When Eddie Carlson and Mr. Gandhi and Mr. Dingwall, when they all sat down and talked about this, I don't know if that's what they had in mind, but that's what we have now.
I think in a lot of ways we're still living the World's Fair, whether people know it or not, because I think Seattle is a city that contains in its DNA this kind of utopian thinking. It's not enough just to live here, we have to live in the best place.
I think that has always been a spirit of Seattle. I mean, there is kind of a mindset that if you really believe in something, you can accomplish it. And I don't think you find that in every city this size.
There's part of Seattle which is about embracing being different and cool.
The World's Fair of 1962 challenged the people of Seattle to rise above their petty parochial neighborhood concerns, to see the larger picture, and challenge the best within us to come to the fore.
I mean, 1962. Other people from my generation that have been movers and shakers that are Seattle-based were also in their formative years.
What made Bill and myself so kind of optimistic and fearless probably was being imbibed with that spirit of, wow, all these things are possible. Wow, a monorail is possible, a crazy space needle is possible. It's that feeling that things are within your grasp.
You never know what sort of seeds you're going to plant. And Seattle's World's Fair helped us become a more can-do society, a more outward-looking society, ultimately a more technologically sort of savvy and aggressive society. And not only Seattle, but a lot of places beyond Seattle have benefited from that.
There was a time when it all came together. There was a time when we really embodied those kinds of hopes and dreams, not just for ourselves, but really for the whole nation. And that's what I think, to me, that the World's Fair sort of represents, what the Space Needle represents. It's kind of a pinnacle of a kind of Seattle ideal that took place at a particular time. It's not necessarily reproducible, but we're still trying to accomplish the things that are embodied in this.
See you in Seattle. See you at the fair. Take away a head look at tomorrow, just as if you were there. Take a rocket trip to Mars. Have your dinner way up in the clouds. Stroll the boulevards of the world. Have fun with the happy-go-lucky crowds. See you in Seattle at the big World's Fair. Everybody's talking about the big World's Fair in Seattle, where a thousand different thrills are setting the pace for a fascinating trip into a world of space at the big